Many of the nobles were among the first to suggest the surrendering of their privileges. Vivienne hardly noticed. She was so overcome with grief and despair, she rarely rose from her bed. By the end of August, the National Declaration of the Rights of Man and the Citizen were drawn up and published. "I notice women aren't granted any rights," Vivienne said bitterly to Pyrrhic. He had taken up his role as her footman again, though he seemed to spend all his time drinking in the inns and gathering rumours. He tried to grin. "Why do women need rights? They have men to take care of them." Vivienne's chest felt tight. No man in her life had ever cared for her, apart from Pyrrhic, who was divided from her by a vast chasm of privilege, and David, who was dead. Vivienne feared her father and had hated her husband. They had only cared for her lands, which were now worthless, which meant she was worthless.
"Mademoiselle, don't cry," Pyrrhic said in alarm. "I was only joking."
"I'm not crying," Vivienne said,
even though she was. September was a month of unrest and deprivation. Despite a rich harvest, bread was scarce. The multitudes of beggars and vagrants were swelled by periwig makers, silk weavers, jewelers, and mantua makers, their luxury goods no longer in demand as the court emptied of its nobles. Those who remained were in a fever of self-denial. Duchesses and marquises donated their earrings and rings to the commoners. So many men cut off their silver shoe ornaments that a long chain of interlinked buckles was carried into the assembly. From that time on, it was seen as dangerous and subversive to wear ostrich feathers in your hair, rings on your fingers, or lace on your fichu. Overnight, women began to wear loose white gowns without frills or ribbons or jewels.